Wood, a favorite of architects, interior designers, and landscape artists across the world. The consumption of wood has been increasing over the years. This growing demand for wood has led to global deforestation, resulting in massive climate change and global warming. On the one hand, consumption of wood has to be reduced, and on the other, most alternatives like fiberglass, WPC, etc. do not transcend the utility, functionality, elegance and performance of wood. Until now. Introducing Tipwood, 100% wood substitute that inherits not only all the properties of wood, but in many a case proves better than wood. And yes, it is probably the most environment friendly wood substitute ever developed. So, how does Tipwood add more value to their projects, as well as help the environment? Made from natural jute fibers and synthetic resins, Tipwood is an ideal wood replacement. It is also an environment-friendly material with an extremely low carbon footprint. Tipwood delivers on every aspect that wood does. It delivers on long life, performance, elegance, and is also as versatile and easy to use. It is 100% substitute to wood. Tipwood is available in different lengths and various cross sections, shapes and sizes to suit every expectation. Tipwood is made in more than 25 different profiles for various applications and end uses. Tipwood is eco-friendly, flame retardant, termite resistant, has a very low carbon footprint, absorbs significantly lower moisture than wood, and is more durable. Come, take a look at some remarkably developed applications using Tipwood. An 80 feet pergola, a 34 by 34 foot pyramid, landscaping, claddings in small to high-rise structures, and is extensively used in gates, fences, cabins, screens, partitions, cabanas, pergolas, construction, louvers, decking, furniture, aesthetic elevations for exteriors, gardens, homes, exhibition venues, educational institutions, and many more. Tipwood's qualities have been recognized not only in India, but even in international markets, and has already started being used in Europe. It is time to add your bit to the environment. It is time to think beyond wood. It is time to use Tipwood. Tipwood, think beyond wood.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this session of IDEC webinar on building material for a sustainable tomorrow. Thank you, IDEC, for creating this platform and this opportunity for all of us. And I do hope that what we discuss does not remain just a discussion, and there are takeaways which can be implemented in a daily life. So, one of the most positive impact of COVID-19 has been the remarkable improvement in the air and water pollution level across the nation, more so in town and cities, for the first time in decades. Mother Earth too has also responded very swiftly. So this implies that by extension, a very sustainable existence, though not easy, is certainly within our reach. So can we then expect that just the way COVID-19 has hastened the work from home process, it will also boost our efforts to lead a sustainable way of existence? What are the components of a larger picture of a sustainable existence? What is Indian situation and what are the issues unique to our context? What do we need to do at the governmental, societal, professional, institutional and individual level to bring back a quality of life, which to me is actually a fundamental right? How do we ensure that we as humans can coexist harmoniously with other species on Earth? How do we leave it as a better place for the future generations to come? These are the questions that we need to ask ourselves. However, our focus today is on building materials for a sustainable tomorrow. So we will only be briefly touching upon these in order to establish a context, and we do hope to leave you with more questions as I think we all need to introspect on the role each of us has played so far and going forward will need to play. So I will start this discussion with Srikanth. And Srikanth, the question to you is, you have been a proponent of sustainable design that respects our long and slow evolution, tradition and culture, an inclusive response as opposed to an engineering or a technological response. You are also actively involved in guiding the educational approach of many leading design institutions. Could you please outline sustainable design approaches as a way of life integral to our value system and our culture and our context, and also share your thinking on institutional role in making sustainability an integral part of design thinking? Over to you, Srikanth.
Yeah, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. And thank you very much, Tushar, for initiating this. The way you ask me a question, it gives an impression that as if I have the authority to change the whole world. It's not so. Let us look at the history, what has happened up till now, how we have progressed, and what are our future challenges. And you are talking about sustainable design. So first of all, let us understand that what is the role of design. And essentially, although all the people who will be attending, all of you are designers, we need to understand that the role of designer is to facilitate and communicate the way of living. That is what one is looking for. Then, of course, design is expected to facilitate that. For that, we use resources, and which are generally drawn from the earth, nature, which is there around us. So design influences cultures, culture shapes values, and value shapes future. And when we are talking about the future, we have to understand this connection of design and the role of sustainability of it. Now, today we are witnessing that there is 6.3 billion population, global population, and it is expected that by 2050 or 2060, the global population is going to be 9.3 billion. So there is going to be a huge increase in the population. There is also, we have to understand that the urban population in 19th century, it was 13%, which is gone to 25% in 1950. And in 2030, it is expected that it will go to about 60%, that is about 5 billion. You know, that's a huge shift which is likely to happen. Now, all those things we need to take into account when we are talking about our role as a designer. What do we want to do? Because on one side, we are seeing this increase in population. On the other side, we also need to understand by eagerness to use the resources, our natural resources have depleted in last 300 years to 50%. And that has raised a serious question that are we on a right path? Are we doing the right things? And here I just want to restrict myself to the Indian condition. If we see the designers population, 1972, when the Council of Architecture was formed, till from then onward, today we have 460 colleges of architecture who are expected to give design education. Those who are facilitated to the society, you know, and there are about 150 schools. Every year from these 460 schools, there are about 24,000 graduates. They are expected to come out in the market, and about 10,000 designers. So it's a huge population. If we see the curriculum and the way the programs are offered, generally the entire program is covered under aesthetics, technology, skills, and humanity, and very little sensitivity is given about the understanding of environment and nature. You go across to all the schools and you will find that none of the schools have a dedicated program on environmental issues. At the master's level, some schools do have this. But there is no strategic planning for this to address this particular challenge. And that's a serious thing, because I think we need to understand that this is our responsibility. Second point, we also need to understand why India is a very peculiar thing in that sense. In Indian context, even today, when we are talking about 1.3 billion population, 68%, about 70% of the population still lives in villages. There are 6,38,596 villages across the country. Out of that, there are about 2 lakhs odd villages where the population is less than 500. And even the basic facilities have not reached to them. The quality of life is not affordable to them. And on the other side, when we talk about the role of the building construction industry, 16%, that is 30 million, around 30 million, Shabirji might correct it, people are engaged in building construction activity as a laborer or facilitator. And they are generating about 200 plus billion rupees worth of assets for the country. So it is an important, it is second largest industry next to agriculture. And if you consider the interior design profession, probably this 200 billion may go to 400 billion. I'm not an economist. But all these things are very important for us, because on one side, it is a vehicle through which our prosperity is increasing. On the other side, we don't have the sufficient expertise at the academic level to address these issues. We don't have any formal program. We don't have any formal approach for this. And we cannot afford to let it go, because it is important that we leave something better for the subsequent generation, new generation. The time is running out, and that is where we are. So,
yeah. So thanks. I think that's quite an interesting take in terms of numbers also, and its numbers are definitely staggering, and so is the enormity of the situation. And we will revert back on that while we now go to Malaji. So Malaji, you straddle IGBC, Griha, and Leeds, and handle very brilliant size of projects in urban context. You were born and brought up in National Hill Region of Himachal Pradesh and have experienced both the environments. What is the difference in the issues faced by rural and urban medium, and the biggest challenges and the opportunities that you see in creating sustainable environments?
Good evening. I think Tusharji, I would like to just say that Shrikantji just rightly said that sustainable development is the need of the hour, because we have only one Mother Earth and there is no planet B. And when we said need of the hour, so that may be urban area, that may be rural area. So basically we need to think sustainability in both the contexts. Maybe I'm sitting in Himachal or I'm sitting in Mumbai, any metro region I'm sitting. So sustainable development has to be a part of my living. So when we say building green or building sustainable, so I also say that not only building, but living green also. So when we say building and living, they both things are very, very important component. When we talk about this sustainability as a, you know, with a holistic way, when we say. And coming to the, as Shrikantji rightly said, that in ancient times, he just mentioned that what past centuries, the kind of development, you know, in the rural areas or other parts of the country, the living style we had, I totally agree with him. But if you see the Vedic science and our ancient mythology, where we were talking about, you know, some Vedic principles, minimum possession and recycle and reuse, which we are talking today again. The same thing, we are repeating the history, because we were talking minimum possession means in Sanskrit, we used to say a parigriha. So that means we were already talking about the reduction principle. We were talking about recycle and reuse. So I think we are just trying to come back, you know, again, we want the same culture. We are again trying to integrate the same principles in our life, what we had already. When we, if we talk about our ancient civilization. So because I'm from Himachal, born and brought up there. So I have seen a culture of full of diversity and, you know, a different kind of architecture. in different places, and the kind of materials the people were using, you know, for making their homes, for their building. They were using more local materials, indigenous materials. So I have been, you know, born and brought up in that culture. And we never thought what is green building that time or sustainable development, because it was an integral part of my living style, my culture. Because, and very, very sorry, I would like to express here, if you see today my native place, it is just a concrete jungle today. Small town, but a concrete jungle. Way we are doing there also. So that is a big area where we need to focus on. We need to work with the policy makers also in those smaller towns, smaller states like Himachal, like me. That is a one just aspect I would like to express here. And secondly, when coming to the Bombay, where I'm staying in the metro city now. So because here I know that sustainable development is a need of the hour. We need more environmental conscious approach now. Because previously, if you see that, we were just using this green and sustainable concept as a voluntary program. But now it has to be a part of our development. If I'm a decision maker, if I'm a government, I'm a policy formulator, then I need to think environmental consciousness as a part of my policy. As today, our particular this program is on the building materials for the sustainable tomorrow. So let me connect it with that also. Because when we talk about building materials for sustainable tomorrow, means we need green products, means we need sustainable products here. So sustainable products and green living will go side by side. Because product integration in the building design, in your construction process, in your operational process, this has to be integrated, you know, throughout, from your design, construction, operation, throughout. So that is a very, very big thought process. Now we need to, I would say, give focus on sustainable development has to be there in place. And we need to think about responsible development. Whatever role I'm playing as an individual, as a builder, as an architect, as a consultant, or as a government policy maker. So everybody has to work consciously now with respect to environmental aspects and its impact on the environment. Thank you.
Yes, now.
Thank you so very much. And I think it's an excellent direction that you're referring to of balancing what we have experienced in the last few days with what we have been doing. I mean, and arriving at something that works for all of us in the long term. And we will again come back to you on that when we move to Shabirji. Shabirji, you have been consistently incorporating sustainable approaches and IGBC rating in all your projects, which is quite rare in the fraternity of real estate development. And could you please share the kind of measures that you have been taking and how this translates into a commercially beneficial approach? And what are the gains and what is the additional capital outlay that is needed to achieve or implement these measures?
So, good evening, friends. At K-Raja Corp, when we started on this journey 10 years back, people thought that we were crazy to do this sustainable development in India because of the fact that, one, it had an extra cost at that time, and whether there was a real market for these kind of sustainable buildings across the sector. But when we do business in the country, we don't look at doing business in the short term or in the medium term. Our top management was very clear that sustainable buildings, whatever we are constructing, whether it is a green office or a green home or a green hotel or a green mall, it would be a sustainable building for the entire group. Having said that, we were the first ones to sign a memorandum of understanding with CII, IGBC in terms of making all our buildings green, in terms of our portfolio in the west and south of the country. Having said that, the journey itself was difficult in terms of implementing sustainable buildings in the country. When we looked at getting sustainable products, not many were available in our country. When we looked at sustainable technologies and consultants, that was another area which was, or whether you can get you know, fly ash blocks easily available, or whether you look at recycle material in the aluminium or in ACP. All that was looked at very carefully during the entire process. Having said that, what our company wanted to look at the whole portfolio of the entire building industry, because we were looking at constructing not less than 2 to 2.5 crore square feet of construction on a yearly basis. So we reached out to our customers, namely, we construct IT SEZs across the country. So we reached out to our customers in Europe and in the US who understand, you know, what green building is. And green buildings make business sense, in the sense that if my customer is occupying a green health in terms of the whole building performing and resulting in lower power and lower water consumption. So this obviously helps in is lower operating cost for the entire building. And for an IT customer, it works out to a lower per seat cost. So because of the fact that it made business sense, there is a huge jump in green buildings across the country. And Mala has played a critical role in that, with billions and billions of green buildings now presently available in this country. Thank you.
Shabiji, would you like to elaborate more on the kind of measures, specific measures that you have taken?
So there are various measures in terms of how a green building is designed and constructed. So we all know that it is a mixture of passive architecture and you know, a lot of engineering which goes in terms of the whole process. The entire building design is put onto a computer, and the various climatic conditions of that particular place are taken, which throws up various measures like what, like the technical parameters of the glass to be used, which allows the light in and not the heat in, or the air conditioner COP chiller parameters, which looks at the amount of fresh air which is going to come into the building. Now, that is very important right now in the COVID-19 scenario, because one, the air conditioning parameters are drastically going to change in light of the COVID-19 pandemic. But green buildings have already gone a step further, and by using MERC 13 filters in IGBC gold plated building, you are anyway filtering out a lot of microbes before they really enter your building. The other factor which is very important in India is saving in of water, which is a very precious resource for our country. So when we look at various water saving measures, whether you look at a sewage treatment plant which recycles your water, in your flushing water is all recycled water, your gardening water is all recycled water, or you have for the taps which have a very low flow rate, or you have a flush tank which has got a dual flushing of a lower capacity, all that results in lower water consumption. Other than the fact for power, when we look at a COP of greater than 6.1, it results in a lower power cost for the consumer, both for an office and for a home. So it's a lot of architecture design and a lot of MEP engineering which goes in green building design, including the materials and the contracting.
Thank you so very much. I think that was quite educative. We'll now move to Sheetal. Sheetal, you represent the third generation of entrepreneur and pioneer in plastic industry, and I would request you to share your views on our country's receptivity to sustainable products, the obstacles that you have faced, or the pitfalls that you have experienced in the process of promoting materials, and as well as the opportunities available, and how do you think the industry can help develop material and technology that enables societal integration towards a sustainable living.
Thank you, Tushar Bhai. I'm glad I went forth because I take away from the previous three speakers. Shrikanji told us about the past and the future and where the vision should be. Malaji explained about Griha and IGBC and how these regulations and these certifications are helpful for sustainability. And Raija Corp already is a sustainable builder, and that's a very big encouragement. I'll talk about our experience as a standalone company. We have taken 2 decades in developing a product, but the market acceptability has been there in the last 9 to 10 years, and good acceptability. We had obstacles, competition and lobbying from age-old traditional products, educating the user right from the common man that who used to visit us on our stalls all the way up to MNCs. And that is a slow process, but it is a successful process. There was a price barrier. There still is. We are told by our customers sustainable has to be cheap, but hidden advantages and the economics have to be explained. It's an education process. You know, when you take a product like this, which is hollow, which is stronger, which is lighter, in the long run, it is cheaper. But when they compare it to wood, it may not always be at par. So you have to explain the sustainability angle from the natural crop of the fiber that we use here to the yarn and fabric, to the processing of tip wood without generating any wastage, to supplying cut to length sizes, and to supplying lightweight, stronger, cheaper sections, and to the ease of installation itself. All of this adds up to a green product, which makes it sustainable by virtue, which is contributing to an environment or a society without being a burden on resources. We are adding to our protection of green cover, preventing global warming, and that's what makes it sustainable. So we have had pitfalls, like we were early in the market. We have still an upward task of explaining environment protection to everybody. It is an education that starts at the school level, goes all the way into business. On the commercial front, India has banned felling of wood, but import is not banned. So you are still creating a demand for a product. That's always going to be there. Unlawful logging is still going on. There are no strict penalties on defaulters, and that's always going to be there. Like Shabirji said, the red tape in government for approvals of alternate building materials are also there. And long-term cost benefits are overlooked, citing purchase costs. But all said and done, the future is bright. The opportunities are immense and fantastic. With a growing global population, conservation of resources is more important, especially now, especially this year onwards. Our concentration has to be on bringing sustainability to every aspect of our lives. And we are only a small scratch on the surface. We are only a small contributor. Apart from our future, we see that apart from landscaping and exteriors, which we are already prevalent, we are looking at outdoor structural cabins, which a little bit on, I'm going to talk about. Other segments is infrastructure, hotels and hospitality, schools and institutions, ecology protection, forest protection, water conservation. We have a case study to share, but it's just nascent, so I'm just going to cite it. And getting into transportation and railways, that's also where we see that sustainable products can help. I hope I've answered your.
Now we move to the second part, and we go to take a closer look at building materials for a sustainable tomorrow. So, advent of television in the 80s and economic liberalization in the 90s opened our eyes to the rest of the world, enabled easy travel and entry of international companies and products. It was a brave new world, and all of us were very excited about that. New material, new technology overshadowed our roots And with that, the tried and tested way of sustainable approach to design and building material techniques, etc., started changing. And of course, some not so unwelcome developments were also there, not so welcome developments also there, such as instead of being protecting from the sun, which is what our country largely needs, we started using glass and other materials extensively, and then trying to create a climate, suitable internal climate for that. The LEED certification also entered as an import along with the capital intensive engineering approach till IGBC and GRIHA started making it more relevant to our climate and our context. Sustainable internal Indian material and interpretations have started coming in. Admittedly, it's been a slow process. But COVID-19 has opened up a huge potential for India to be a manufacturing hub for many industries. And with that, one can hope that a whole lot of new material which is relevant to our context would also start indigenously being manufactured and developed. So this question is a common question, but I would like to start this with Malaji. What is your take on the need and the potential of making indigenous material and products and of rediscovering and refining skills relevant to our climate and context to take the country forward?
Thank you. Water efficient or sustainable? So point here is, first, I think we should understand what is green product, what is sustainable product. With coming to the green product, it is a product which is also designed, so optimally using less resources and also using some recycled content, less amount of energy, less amount of water, and having less emissions, which is for sustainable tomorrow. So that means we need to understand project owner requirement, like from the first day of your designing, if my designer, he understand what kind of building envelope has to be there in a specific climatology. So your 50% job is over because you are making your design in such a way so that you are taking care all the building envelope, what kind of wall you are making, what kind of roof you are constructing, what kind of building blocks you are using, bricks you are using, the kind of glazing you are using. So basic your 50%, I would say the problem is solved about the building materials when you integrate this particular concept in the design itself, because you know the envelope which is sustainable that to particular climatology. And you know, after that, there is a lot of role of your interior products, which we say green interior products. Then you need to understand what are those elements, what are those products which we are supposed to use in a green building. Let me tell you, when you manufacture a green product, you take care of so many aspects, which is a life cycle cost analysis also, because you understand whether what is the raw material, and then you know what is your manufacturing process, what is the end product, and how you know it is having the impact on the environment, then how user friendly it is, then what is the cost analysis of that, what is the capex, what is the opex. So many analyses which need to be done when we look into the material analysis in a building design. So as an expert, we see that if designers and your MEP consultant and all consultants who are on board with the decision maker, they do a quantitative and qualitative analysis with respect to building materials. Once they identify on the table, these are my civil materials I'm going to use, how much will be the quantity, because quantity also matters. Because the resource utility you are doing, that is also very important, how much you are using. It is not something that I'm using a huge amount of resources, then I'm cutting down. But better is, it's always the advisable to use less first, then recycle and reuse. Same principle we apply in a green building. So resource efficiency, when it comes to the table of a design, we look into your whether how you can optimize your building envelope. When I say optimization, so as rightly said by Shabir ji, that CARE Hai Ja, all projects, you know, they look into the building envelope, they do the energy simulation in the planning stage itself. So they understand whether what kind of envelope they require in that particular climate. So they understand what is the specification of their glass, what kind of wall assembly they will be requiring, whether they will be using AC blocks or they will be using red bricks, whatever. So everything is being decided on the table in the planning stage itself. Because specification laid down in the planning itself helps us to make an integrated approach during the purchase process. So when we are saying building green, So purchase department plays a very, very important role, because your purchase process, your green purchase, I would say it's a chain actually for the market. Green purchase policy has to be there in place, because even there is also confusion after that. What is green and what is non-green? Because, you know, most of the products in the market, they say green, some because they use those logos, we are green or non-green, because that also need to be identified. So when I said there are two kind of approaches when you are building green, one is the either you have to give emphasis to the certified green products and certified sustainable technologies. One aspect is that, as I give you the example of Green Pro certification, and if you see the energy products of ECBC, B star rated products, that is also available by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency, especially in the air conditioning industry and for the lighting fixtures. But for the construction industry, we have in IGBC more than 1,000 products, which are steel, which are cement, which are wood material, which are your panels, insulation, and paints also. If you look into the some alternative products like tipsum, tip wood is also using, like your Tusharji, your product is also using some alternative material, you know, instead of wood. You are giving a preference to now plastic, waste plastic in that. So I think that is also the very good and innovative approach when we building green, because those products are helping us to innovate and to think, you know, beyond, I would say, what is available in the market. And we could use that alternative material, and which is procured from the renewable resources, because that product is manufactured from the renewable resources. We are giving preferences to the low VOC materials also, low VOC paints, low VOC adhesive and sealants also. And let me tell you, VOC is a very, very important aspect in the green products. That is a volatile organic compound. So we have some benchmarks. So we, as an expert, look into those specifications and look into the compatibility and benchmarks, so that, you know, that product we are using in any form in the building construction industry, that has to be eco-friendly. So that finally we are saying we are building green. So then it is a justice with the building of green. Once you use the green product, we understand the sustainable technologies, its specifications, its resource efficiency. As I think Shabirji also said about the air conditioning use. Because in India, you know, mostly commercial buildings are, we are using air condition. But in the residential, still I would say we are using naturally ventilated buildings. So there we use more natural fans. We are using, you know, naturally ventilated windows. So here we apply different strategies. So we look into the design aspect of natural ventilation here. We look into the star-rated fans. We look into the star-rated LED lights, lighting fixtures. So the approach also varies depending on the type of project you are dealing with. But when it comes to the commercial project, like Shabirji said that we are using, you know, with high COP, coefficient of performance in the air conditioning industry. So that is also depending upon the size and scalability of the project. If it is a bigger size of commercial building, so in that case, you are using centralized air conditioning. You go for the water cool chiller there. So you need to look into the COP value of SOP. You need to match it with the ASHRAE standard. You look into ECBC standard also, as for the local bylaws. So, you know, it's all, I would say, the material analysis and technology interventions. This need to be looked after through quantitative and qualitative analysis in the planning itself. So we understand for my specific building, it is a residential or it is commercial, what I need actually. So you can't be just set SOP for all categories. So it also depends which climatology your building is you are constructing. And you know, what are the local requirements? What are the regional priorities? And what are the material availability also? And where is the, because in green building, we don't only focus on the green products. We also focus on the local economy. We also focus on the local materials, because we want to focus, you know, to increase the local economy, local business. We want to empower, you know, the local employment opportunity also to the people. So this is what I would say, green product is a huge market for the new entrepreneur also, when they are also coming into and, you know, evolving with the new products, new technologies, new alternative thought process of making something new. That is also helping us, and it will help us a lot in the construction industry. And it is already helping, because Rome was not built in a day. But we have already started the way, the sustainability journey is on. So I would say, with a positive note, that whether things are happening now, we are in the starting stage, but definitely now, you know, when we spread more awareness, taking these concepts to the grassroots level, as Shrikant ji said in the beginning, that green education in the architectural students, and you know, we need more environmental education parameters. So I think that way this kind of awareness will spread, and it will really have a huge impact positively on the entire community. So I, as a decision maker, I understand what is my requirement. As an architect, I understand my design requirement. As an MEP consultant, I understand my requirement. And then everything we put together on single table, holistically, with integration, I think that is the best approach. And we understand finally how much I need to use and how much I can recycle, how much we can reuse again. So I think we are applying this 3R principle in a very holistic manner. So you have the green building rating system in the place. You can use those tools. You can use local bylaws, environmental regulations also of ECBC, Energy Conservation Building Code, national building codes are there. So it is all your thought process at the end, and you know how you implement, execute. That is a very, very important, especially decision makers plays a very, very important role in that. So I appreciate K. Raheja for this kind of inspiration in the industry.
Thank you. Thank you so much. One question to you, that you had said that around 1,000 IGBCS certified around 1,000 products.
Yes.
So how many of these are indigenously manufactured and how many of these are indigenously developed?
Yeah, Tusharji, as I said, that Green Pro is a kind of certification program. If you go through the website of IGBC Green Pro, so you will find the proper, you know, there is a process given there. So even any product where they feel that their product is eco-friendly and they feel that their manufacturing process, they are using some recycled content in the manufacturing and they are using some sort of raw material, which is itself is eco-friendly, and they are also using less resources to manufacture that particular product, they can register and they can follow the process, and IGBC is there to help, you know, to certify their product by this LCA program, life cycle cost assessment. So there is a proper process which is already in the website. So that basically verify and validate whether your product is green or not. I think one thing I forget and put here, which is very important, because in the green products, one thing is using of products. Other thing is the material efficiency in the green building sector. Because when we do, the structural consultant also plays a very, very important role here. Because when you are building green, your structural consultant also can play a very, very important role by reducing the resource consumption. Because he can guide us how to use steel, how can minimize the uses of steel, how we can minimize the usage of cement, because they are very, very high intensive, and you know, the kind of product where the carbon footprint is very high. So structural efficiency is also integral part of the green building process. So green building is a very holistic manner. It is not just using and choosing green product only, but understanding of the green product and its efficiency with a qualitative and quantitative approach. That is also very important and very specific to the climatology and specific to the project type. Then, you know, at the end, what you get the benefit, rightly said by already Shabir ji, that they are already getting some tangible benefit and intangible benefits. Because when we say tangible benefits, that comes to your operational and maintenance cost, because your electricity bills are less, because your building envelope is designed in such a way so that you are cutting down your electricity usages. And you are procuring your water efficiency products also in that way. So you are cutting down water bills also. And you are minimizing waste also. So finally, you are helping, you know, your national priorities of environmental regulations. You are helping your green economy. And you are also increasing, I would say, employment opportunities for the young entrepreneurs. So this is making, you are making a green market in the industry. So I would say green product plays a very, very big role. Green building development is playing a very big role. And after COVID-19, I would suggest my government also to give, you know, more focus to the green building and green products. And they should be incentivized also. This
thank
is what,
so
yeah.
A lot of information.
And, yeah, thank you.
Thank you so very much. And we'll move to Shabir ji now for his take on potential.
Can you hear you? Yeah. Okay.
So, Shabir ji, I was asking for your take on the as somebody who has been procuring a lot of material over the last 10 years, you would be aware of the shift in the market trend and in terms of availability of indigenously material, which is qualitatively at par with what you may have been importing earlier.
Yes. So in the last 10 to 12 years, there has been a gradual shift of sustainable products getting manufactured in this country. There are various examples across various factories which have been started, like Saint-Gobain has started factory in Chennai for green glass. Then you would have the bathroom CP sanitary guys who manufacture low water faucet urinals or WCs or basins. They have started factories in parts of Gujarat. Or we look at recycled aluminium facade products. These have begun too. So a lot of indigenous manufacturing activity has gone in this space. Having said that, yes, unfortunately, you know, when you look at air conditioning products, or when you look at DGs, or whether you look at chillers, or whether you look at lifts, still a lot of these are coming from China only, because China tends to supply this to the rest of the country, to the rest of the world. So there is a big opportunity for India now to look at you know, manufacturing these kind of high-end air conditioning, electrical and lift products in this country. There are lift manufacturers available here, but they tend to make lifts which are low speed or which assemble a lot of products which come from China. So the trend to increase indigenous manufacturing, especially in the light of COVID-19, is very strong for all of us. The products which are locally available and need to be also available in the kind of volumes which we require. So if India is looking at a certain GDP growth, and we are going to look at an X crore square feet of construction across the country, so these products, the mass and the volume which China manufacturers manufacture for the rest of the world needs to happen in India. But yes, the indigenous part of sustainable products, there has been a dramatic increase in our country, as a result of which, of course, costs have gone down in terms of constructing, you know, green buildings.
That's a lot of excellent information, and it does mean that, you know, there is a way that we can move forward, and if the red tape and the bureaucracy is reduced, India would be in a position to actually take this opportunity and start manufacturing a lot of products indigenously. Thank you, sir. And Shrikant, what do you think is your take on...
I certainly don't have the kind of experience which Shabishji or Malaji have. But my overall understanding on this is, first of all, is we don't seem to have a coordinated effort on this R&D and trying to promote indigenous manufacturing of the kind of materials, kind of equipments which are required for the building industry. There are scattered efforts done by small people, or sometimes by some industries, but that is in isolation. And the reason is that, you know, for example, I learned that National Chemical Laboratory certainly made certain kind of research, and they got some patents, and they are useful for the building products in India. I don't know at the operational level whether any industry has taken those and whether they are willing to manufacture those and make a business out of it. So first and foremost thing is that we need to have a kind of a coordinated platform where the researcher, manufacturer, and the customer, and of course designer, they need to be together. You know? And we cannot certainly, it is a big business, it is a big opportunity because of the current COVID-19, post-COVID-19 situation. But unless we have the integrated policy, otherwise we'll lose the opportunity, you know. And we don't have much time also. At the same time, I am also seeing that, you know, especially regions like Europe, they are looking for the inward-looking economy. Now they are thinking of less global connection in terms of their economic planning and economic development. India did have pre-90 inward-looking economy, and we did suffer, but we also had certain benefits where we could develop, we could have a lot of small-scale industries coming in and having the, because ultimately to run an industry, to start, take a risk, you need to have entrepreneurial quality. And that entrepreneurial quality, I think India seems to have the, everyone seems to have that in India. It is far, we are prone to take risk many times, and you know, that's good actually quality. The only thing is that we need to convert that into a business model. That's what I see. I don't understand this rating and all those things, although I, once upon a time, I had gone in deep depth for all those things. But I only understand that whatever resources we use from the Mother Earth, and whatever we throw, that also goes to Mother Earth. So it is our responsibility that we have the correct balance sheet towards the end of our life.
Do you want to add something to this in terms of what kind of incentives would you look for indigenous production to move forward in a better manner?
Thank you. The incentives I covered in the beginning, that we need more help from government, which is slowly coming. The awareness in the industry is also increasing. We are also looking inward where we are failing or where we are falling short. Sometimes the finish is just very base, or you need more varieties. We are looking at diverse fibers, hybrids, different surface finishes. We are trying to look at bioresins. Without deviating from sustainability or the low carbon footprint, we are seeking ideas from all partners, whether he's a customer or a supplier. The current situation this year, this month, has resolved our motto, our 3R motto, which was reduce, reuse, recycle. To add a fourth one, reduce, reuse, recycle, and reinvent. So forums like this and reaching out to people, it is going to help. The incentives are there. A lot of it is self-motivation, and we want this to move ahead, because the idea of Tipput came from coming to a situation not like this pandemic, but from a situation where we have water scarcity or green cover scarcity. So the incentives are inbuilt in our environment. We have to protect it. I think I answered it in a different way, but
okay.
Your take on the kind of incentives or the kind of encouragement that you look for more of these products to happen, either at governmental level or at the level of users or at the level of rating agencies, what do you think could be done for people to go more for these products and manufacturers to want to make these products?
See, we need to look at the broader picture of the fact that if we are able to know, construct any type of green building, whether it's a green home or a green office, at a lesser cost, that then it is eventually going to benefit the customer financially in addition to lower power and water cost. Having said that, if manufacturers are able to do this in a way that they can even export green products out of this country to other countries, like in the pre-Obama or in the Obama era, the US economy was able to generate a lot of revenue in manufacturing both green products, other than the fact that they created a lot of jobs, what he called as green jobs in the US for these kind of products. So as far as India goes, it is a twofold positive for the country, that there will be a lot of jobs which will be constructed, which will be made available for the factory which is going to manufacture this product. And if these products have certain kind of incentives from the government, whether it is in terms of a lower GST rate, if it is an IGBC certified green product, that is going to help to push these products more down the line, and a lot more developers will look at, constructing more green buildings. So other than the fact that the factory production hindrances are removed and they need to be made available both to the developer as well as to the common man, because it's not only the developer who's going to pick up your green products, it is going to be the particular common man. Like a lot of societies in Mumbai and other parts of the country have started using solar panels on the rooftops so as to reduce their power costs and go sustainable in green. So these will eventually help out both in terms of more green jobs and a lesser cost.
I think I am sorry, but I think we don't have more time to actually have more discussions. But can we quickly close this by sharing what do you think are the newest products that each of you are excited about? I'll quickly start with Malaji, make it short, and you can just give 5 products that you think are exciting and emerging.
Tushaji, you said 5 products.
Yes.
Let me tell you, because there are so many varieties actually. Right now, there is a huge opportunity in the market for the construction as well as the, I would say, civil construction as well as a technology intervention also. Yeah. But coming to the civil construction only, the products which we have right now, you can use green concrete. Okay. Then you can use AC blocks, automated aerated concrete blocks. Because in the industry, like especially in the urban areas, we are using more concrete in the Myburn, and that is very common nowadays to get a faster construction. So I think AC blocks and fly ash bricks are the good options here. And apart from that, good insulation products also, which is helping us to optimize the building roof envelope and helping us to achieve the energy efficiency a lot, to meet the ECBC and local building bylaw standards as well. And apart from that, externally, there are some paints, green building, the paints which are having some specific benchmark of volatile organic compound, low VOC. So those paints are helping us to improve the environmental quality if you use it for the external wall envelope, or you can use it for the internal envelope also, for the interiors as well. And apart from that, there are some tiles, vitrified tiles, and there are a lot of, pavers. Pavers also we can use, grass pavers, which is just in the periphery of the building, helping us to, minimize the heat island effect also, so which reduce the heat gain also, and also addressing the biodiversity by increasing the green space also there. Then apart from that, because the site is a very big constraint in the urban area, so we can also use the green walls and vertical gardens. Those are also the green products, nowadays we can integrate in the building design itself. And high SRI paints for the roof, high SRI tiles. SRI means solar reflective index, because we are giving more, encouragement to high SRI products in the green buildings. because heat island effect is a very, very important aspect in the when cities are getting warmer. So those are the green products. And also there are a lot of products for the interior, like which are more, you know, the we can see the alternative as a resource of this. They can be manufactured from the renewable resources like bamboos. Like I think a teak wood is also one of the good, you know, the product we could use as an alternative material for the interiors as well as for the landscapes or cabanas and, you know, some sort of fabrics you want to use architecturally in the periphery of the building, in the landscape element also. And also ACPs, as Shabirji said, that for the building envelope, because it has a very good thermal conductivity and it also helps us to reduce the heat gain. And I think there are, this is a huge list because you gave me an opportunity to speak only the five products.
Yes, thank you.
So I think there is no end. There are so many now.
That's
there are so many. Yeah.
And would anybody like to specifically add any more products to this list that Malaji has already stated?
I think Malaji has covered for everyone. But I think that bamboo one needs to look into seriously, because there was a time when government was treating bamboo as a wood, and when it has come out of the categorization under wood and it has become a grass, there are more opportunities to explore bamboo, and
yes,
that should be there. And of course, natural fiber. There's okra fiber, there is jute, there is water hyacinth, and a lot of Western country, not Western, Eastern countries have done a lot of work on water hyacinth. And here we are paying extra money to remove the water hyacinth from the river and throwing that as a garbage. But that could be used. So natural fiber, basically, I feel that because they are part of the total ecosystem, and you can replant them and then you can reuse them. So those kind of product
could be, yes, I think that's also very interesting alternative to heated product. And yes,
I just want to add two things. I think fiberglass rebars instead of steel rebars are an excellent sustainable product. And also, porous concrete has some excellent advantages.
Yes.
Not only is it sustainable, but is also hygienic in urban areas.
True, and also it manages to retain water, groundwater.
That's right.
But yes. Tushar, one thing I want to just say, that all those things are the actions we are expecting designers or facilitators to take. But somewhere we need to create a spirit of trusteeship, because we are not the owners of this land, Mother Earth. We are the trustees. And that spirit, unless we inculcate right from the childhood, it will not resolve the problem, you know. And somewhere that needs to be inculcated in academics, not at the professional level academics, but right from the childhood. And like people can be told that all the children, they can celebrate their birthdays by planting 10 trees every birthday, you know, it will create a lot of excitement and it will give a lot of opportunities to understand that.
Now this is something that has to happen. It calculated at a very young age, because only then it's going to remain with you.
Okay, thank you for your attention. I'll quickly go through this presentation now, in continuance of the topic of building materials for a sustainable tomorrow. I come back to the beginning where Shrikanji talks about the devastation of human actions on our biodiversity, our depleting forest covers, mainly due to agriculture, civilization, timber, pasture for livestock. And you're all aware, 25 million acres of forest cut down annually. This is a reality. Sustainable reforestation doesn't always match the depleted forest covers. Often it is not of good quality. Again, you are cutting down a tree today and waiting for 15, 20, 25 years for it to grow. It is not a great success in India. And I said this before, laws preventing deforestation are abused very badly. it still happens. India is one of the top 10 highest levels of deforestation in the world. Between 2001 and 2018, we have destroyed 17,000 square kilometers of our green resources. This is all fresh in our memories. 2013 in the Himalayas, 5,000 dead. And the NDMA had declared that this was exclusively only due to excessive deforestation and logging. And what is the solution? We are offering one. I'll talk a little bit more about this. It is a natural fiber composite. It is made from more than 65 to 70% natural fibers. It's a very high content. And here we have jute as our fiber. And it is combined with a binder, which is a resin which we make. It is not just the resin. There are so many other natural fillers in it. So the resin content is very low. It's used in right now exclusively in building and construction landscaping. We have other targets in mind. We have solid and hollow profiles and up to 40 feet in length products. And this is what they look like. They're all made in-house. It's 100% made in India technology. The binder, the resin, we have been making since 1945. And as Shabirji said, that the need of the moment is also taking our green products outside the country. We've already started that, and we're offering turnkey projects for Tipwood in India and overseas. It's a green product. It's truly green. It's truly sustainable. It has a very low carbon footprint. It is 100% eco-friendly. No need to cut any trees. The conversion of manufacturing it, the energy dependence is very low. It is used for lightweighting, for replacing heavy materials. It is circular at end of life, which is going to be many years later. The product can be reground and reused in the same process. So it has a very low carbon footprint. It uses natural fibers, no wastage, cut to length. We've covered this before. It promotes agriculture. It promotes jute mills and gives employment. Uses low energy resins, low energy consumption in the process. It's a flame retardant product. These are its advantages. It's termite proof. It is it's water resistant. It is very low water absorption. It has good electrical properties, high heat resistance. It can be cut, sawn, planed, nailed, drilled, shaped exactly like wood using the conventional tools. These are some of our recent projects. Decking for smart cities, decking in rural areas, bridge over water, decking in urban bungalows, building facades for projects like Mahindra and Loda that you see here. This also offers insulation from the heat. This is landscaping this is at the Malabar Hill Club, landscaping of using Tipwood for pergolas, for decking, for fencing and partitions. Again, large to small trellises, cabanas. Outdoor furniture, seating systems, benches, etc. This is in Europe, already being used. Crash barriers in the rural areas, canal lining, bus stops and cycle stands, and a new application, lighting pole for urban lighting. And it shows some of the profiles that we are using here. Load-bearing structures. Some of these installations are familiar to you guys. Maybe some of them are very old and still existing. These earlier were made with our older profiles, but now last year in 2019, we specially made these sections that you can see, which are structural and load-bearing, can be used to make larger structures, cabins with probably this is the third part of my presentation, a case study, cabin in Europe. With our partner in Europe, we have tested and proved that tipped profiles can be used to for a larger use in making outdoor structures. And of almost 400 square feet cabin was made where 90% tipwood was used using these profiles that you see. I'll show you a short video and I'll talk about it. Yeah, I'm back. So that you saw that house, it was, it's a matter of pride, but it was 90% tipwood. The rest was film for waterproofing and bottom layer of WPC for as a base. The rest was all tipwood. There's no heavy metal except screws and glue used. This is a small calculation on the carbon footprint. I'll just very, very briefly go over it. It's not too much. The material here, because of it being hollow, as you can see in the last column of tipwood, only around 5 meter cube used compared to other areas. And that leads to a very low carbon generation that gives you a very low carbon footprint. If there are questions later on, I can answer them and go over this again. There were many bodies involved in this. There were students, there was education bodies, private sector that made this cabin a reality. The next step here is that they are studying this and want to take it to a mass production level, which is where the future should be. Just last couple of slides. This is a mangrove protection project that is going to go on live soon. There are 17 mangrove forests in Bombay. The MOEF is planning to make them into conservation areas and to educate, to experience by way of a walkway through the mangrove using tipwood, and then also an experience center on the outskirts that people can learn about it. Tipwood for railways, this is something that we have just initiated and we hope to see this in the long run. Lightweighting of railway coaches by extruded profiles of tipwood. These are our soon to be coming profiles, a roofing profile, cladding profile. Again, partitions, two different types. We have 50 designs and counting. Our design has come from inputs from industry, input from architectures and designers like yourselves, and consultants like yourselves, in-house designing, and our clients. Clients like Lodha, Mahindra, Adani, large to small builders, urban and regional, different aspects of this of this nation. This is a growing list. It's and it keeps on growing every day. That brings me down to thank you for seeing my presentation. And
yeah, it is helpful and impressive and quite informative. And of course, I by and large know the product. But if any of the analysts would like to understand more about it or have some questions, please feel free to ask.
I think, Tushar, we have used this material and I felt quite happy because it gave a very satisfying result. Only thing is what I feel that we should have for R&D now taking it to the further level, you need to have the very strong inclusion of designers, you know, because these are the components which have multiple possibilities and multiple opportunities. And if the product, you already have 50 odd products, and if they can be expanded, and there actually if you can involve designers, it will help. Because the process of assembly, somewhere if we can have, because right now we are thinking of conventional technology of using screws, and so somewhere here if we can have the process of you know, more better components where the assembly becomes more organized,
yes,
than leaving it to the conventional carpenters, you know, you may have to have some training for this.
Yeah, we are planning to come out with dovetail joinery, sliding in joinery. We want to go more towards the technology of do-it-yourself kits. So all that is definitely in our vision. And thank you for reminding us. And yes, we are planning that, the concept.
Yeah,
Madam.
Can I?
Yeah.
Hi, Cyrilji, wonderful. It is a very good alternative product for us in the application of green building. But my just a technical question, if you could just answer me. Because in the green building, we are giving preference to high SRI materials for the pavers or in the outdoor spaces on the non-roof and roof. Okay. So I just wanted to know whether you have tested your product and what is the SRI value of that? Solar reflective index.
Okay. The solar reflective, let me first say that I am not familiar with, I understand what it is, but I'm not really familiar with it. It's to reflect off the
radiation, the solar radiation.
Radiation and improve the cooling of the interiors. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So we have done fair enough. A lot of testing on this product, weatherability, long-term life cycle analysis, flammability, water resistance, traditional materials. We do not have a reflective index testing done. We can definitely incorporate it. But what I would like to tell you is that when we used it in a location in Agra, in the full blast of the summer, we noticed. This was a empirical testing. We noticed that 10 degree temperature difference reduction.
Okay.
I'm literally saying 10 degree in the peak summer on a wall where we had installed the foot and on a wall which we had not, it was 10 degrees. But yeah. My answer to you is that we can give you proper testing numbers.
Because, you know, there are two applications in the green building, what the material we use is on the top roof, top terrace of the building.
Yeah.
Other is when we use in the lower level, like in the non-roof areas, in the building, yes, periphery. Okay, yes. Like in the landscapes and other elements. And we have different solar reflective index requirements.
Right.
So I could share that with you. So you should get it tested done. And apart from that, you should also go for the thermal properties. Like,
yeah,
thermal conductivity, okay?
Those we have done.
Those you have done. Good, good. And other parties, that is about the chemical, like you are using, I think, phenol-based resins, like for the coating, not the formaldehyde-based products, right?
It's a phenolic, it's a hybrid phenolic resin. And the
okay.
I would say that the percentage is very low. It's around 10 to 11% in the final matrix. And we are doing R&D. We are already under VOC norms there, but we are also doing R&D for replacing it to non-formaldehyde, non-styrenic based binders.
That sounds cool. Yeah, that thank makes you. The product green actually. Yeah,
thank you. You.
मी थोड्या वेळाने करू का? मी मीटिंग मध्ये आहे.
Tushar sir, handing over to you. You can summarize the panel.
I think I'm going a little running behind because.
Tushar sir, handing over to you. You can summarize the panel.
Getting away different feedbacks. I'm getting a video.
A lot of disturbance in the background. Maybe because of your phone, sometimes the phone signals create a problem. You also phones a little away on silent mode. Now it's okay. I think we'll wait for Tushar sir. He had some connectivity issue. Till then, we are just waiting for Tushar sir to summarize the panel discussion. I think he's back. Just a few seconds, audience. Thank you for your patience.
Is it better now?
Perfect. I think the echo was because of your phone. Sometimes the signals create interruptions. So now we are perfect, sir. You can go ahead.
Okay. So thank you for this presentation and everybody's inputs. This has been very, very interesting. And to sum it up, for long, the words sustainable and green have been like two sides of a coin. I believe it's about time they met. As Maharaji said, it has to be a holistic approach. COVID-19 has so visibly demonstrated our goal, that of ensuring that while we ourselves are able to enjoy this world as a great and a healthy gift that the nature and our predecessors have given to us, we leave it as an even better legacy to our successors. This is the trusteeship referred to by Srikant. On a lighter note, if a virus just a trillionth of a gram can do it, surely we can do it. So just as a start, we need to include the following in our design approach and material selection approach. Passive solar control, active solar harnessing, reduction in use of resources, energy and water, increasing the usage of renewable material, minimum negative impact on environment, life cycle cost analysis, reusability, recyclability, and the word that was coined by Sital, reinvention. Reinvention of all ideas, lifestyles, material, technology, and processes, and their integration. That is a new, brave new world that we need to go towards. A world already successfully embraced by Shabirji's organization. So it's doable. Let's just make that happen. And of course, we have had lots of questions by lots of people. I have kind of organized them in, because there are a lot of generic questions. So the first question actually is something that we would like to take up, which is, what is sustainability? This is asked by Nitin. And Sital has expressed a desire to respond. So Sital, over to you.
Thank you, Tushar Bhai. Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. In our opinion at Tripwood, a green product is sustainable by virtue that it contributes to our society, our environment, without being a burden on resources such as energy, green cover, etc. Closer to home, from a natural fiber crop cultivated annually, which creates a livelihood for the farmer, to processing the yarn in the jute industries, creating jobs in a sick and reviving industry, to processing tripwood using minimal energy and reduced wastages, to supplying those tailor-made sections of tripwood as per client sizes, to all these users getting lightweight, strong sections which are cut to length, which in turn give them reduced installation time and cost, thus giving them a long-lasting product for the client, surpassing traditional materials. Finally, to recycling that same product after its end of life into our own tripwood manufacturing process, making the whole product circular. This is what our definition of sustainability is. Hope that answers Nitin Bhai's question.
Thank you, Nitin. Would somebody else like to address the same question? Please.
Yeah, for me, sustainability is basically a triple bottom line. When any development which is being done for people, profit, as well as for the environment. So I feel all these three principles has to be on one single platform when we are doing any kind of development, but not at the cost of degrading the environment. And are looking into the economy also sustainably. So that is a sustainable development.
All right. Thank you so much. There is an observation that please demystify sustainability and create widespread acceptance of sustainability. Srikant, would you like to take that question? Or your take on
that? No. Can you repeat the question again?
Yes. There is a suggestion, there are suggestions, in fact, a lot of suggestions that please demystify sustainability and create widespread awareness and acceptance of sustainability. Your take on that?
I think we have to, because we cannot just talk about professionals offering the solution for sustainability. It should be imbibed, the customer should demand for it. And they also should be, having the understanding of the responsibility when they use the sustainability concept in their houses or whatever work they do. I don't know the meaning of demystify, because there is no tangible, correct mathematical answer for this kind of a question. I can say that everyone has to eat every day to generate 2,500-3,000 calories for themselves, and they choose what to eat and what not to eat, and that is a balanced food which they eat, which generally give them. When we are talking about the material for sustainability, if we just profound one particular material, it is not going to be sufficient, because it has to be a balanced approach, and that is where the designer come in a picture. According to me, design happens at multiple level. It is not only the professional level. And typically there is a design ladder that one is designed by a non-designer. Second is design as a form giving. Third is design as an integrated effort where inside and outside is also integrated. And fourth is design as a strategy. So first is design as a non-designer is generally done by the user without having every day to tell him by the professional designer how to live, you know. They take their own call on it. Similarly, the last strategic role is an integrated effort by designer, by engineers, all the consultants, government policy, policy makers, environmentalists, everybody. And what we are lacking today is a consolidated, integrated policy. And for that, we have to put in our homework as designer to advice to the policymakers. And I don't think that, you know, it should be that you do only sustainable design building, then only you will get some benefit. I think it should be a rule that all buildings should be sustainable. And they have to be actually, it cannot be one uniform solution for across the country because we have various climatic zones, we have various geographical conditions, and every region will have its own code for that. And so I don't think there is a linear answer for this.
No, but you answered it well, and you have in fact addressed the second, sort of question that is again overwhelmingly large number of people have said that the green and sustainable norms and parameters must be made mandatory by the government. So there is a question as to why that is not happening, and like you say, that it is something that we as designers need to actually reach out to the government and support it in creating that as a norm.
See, one point I would like to make clear over here. We need to have norms, but we also have people within our community who falters the norms by finding out a loophole. So unless the spirit is generated amongst the society, these norms will not work.
Absolutely. That is why this whole issue of trusteeship comes in. We have received this gift from somebody else and we need to pass it on to somebody else. And that, and that commitment and sense of responsibility has to happen from within. It is not something that can be imposed upon. I totally agree with that. Shabirji, there is again a lot of people have suggested that incentivize sustainability. Your comments on that?
See, the government needs to look at incentivizing the customer on sustainability. That is very important. So if they look at, giving some benefits on green homes, which they have started doing, like in the Pune Municipal Corporation, if you buy a green home, there is a rebate on your property tax and development charges for the consumer. There are certain government banks which are looking at giving a lower interest rate if you buy a green home. So more than giving the incentives to the developers, the government needs to focus more on giving a substantial reduction to the home consumer if he buys a green home. Because that is where the revolution, if I may say, for a green home will start, as then developers will be forced to construct a green home or a green office or a green school. So, you know, the entire range of sustainability gets done, you know, if the father is going to work in a green office and he goes to a green school and he stays in a green home. So that will complete the entire circle of sustainability. In a practical.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, Malaji.
Yeah, I think I would like to add here the positive size of because you know I always feel whether what is a glass filled, we need to look from that perspective also. If you see the current scenario, the most of the states have already green building incentives in India. I'll give you some examples, like if you see the UP government, Uttar Pradesh, Jharkhand, West Bengal, Himachal Pradesh, and Punjab, Haryana, Gurgaon, including, as Shabir ji says, Pune Municipal Corporation, PCMC. So everywhere you have an incentive policy which is laid down already, and builders like K. Raheja, I think Shabir ji would be agree, already you are getting incentives in your development there. But only in some of the states, we are just pushing the government and, you know, trying to convince that the policy has to be there. So at least if builders come forward, you know, for this initiative, making building green, and also the property tax rebate to the building tenants, you know, that also is in the pipeline. And I think we are pushing as a certification body, IGBC, and interacting with the government. And I think, again, I will say, Rome was not built in a day. Let's hope for the better, best thing. Yeah, things are happening.
Tushar bhai, you're not audible.
Can you hear me now? I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, all right. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. So that was excellent suggestion, Shabir ji. And I think that kind of brings us to the close of the program. We have covered major questions. Of course, there are a lot of smaller questions, and I am sure that interested audiences, members of the audience and the participants can reach out to the panelists and find out or seek out these answers directly from them. And with that, I would like to thank all the panelists for giving extremely valuable insights into this whole notion of sustainability and green. And I do hope we are all able to take this forward in some way or the other. And I would also like to thank IDEC for this wonderful opportunity to all of us to be able to do that, and for handling this program very, very professionally. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Actually, just want to end it by telling the audience that this has been a great session. Thank you so much, especially to the audience to hold on for so long. Thank you so much, all our panelists. It was an amazing session. Thank you, Tusharji, for moderating it so well. And especially our sponsor for today, Tipwood. Without you, our event wouldn't have been possible. Thank you so much, Mr. Seetal. Now, the pending questions will be answered on www.askidac.com. So I request all the audience to log on to www.askidac.com, where all the build professionals of the industry will answer your questions. So I request everybody to sign up soon. Stay safe, stay healthy, take care. Thank you so much. Logging on.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. We still have a lot of audience here. I request everybody to sign up on www.askidac.com, where all your pending questions will be answered by the build professionals of the industry. It is a knowledge sharing platform where in which people from all over the globe answer your queries. And it's an interactive platform. So I request everyone to log on to www.askidac.com. Thank you so much. Logging off, Team IDAC.